Shalom. Islam. Once again, it's the voice of your brother Tazadaq coming at you through the spirit. For the record, I would like to reserve my rights according to the grand architect of the universe, to the creator that granted me my rights. This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, you should seek yourselves a competent counselor, then please be advised. This is for educational, informational, and even entertainment purposes. I want to talk to you about child support, fathers, mothers, sons, daughters, and justice. This topic's going to offend many of you, so if you feel that you may find this offensive, I would encourage you to sign off or turn away from this channel now. When justice, or Yeshua, or Christ, or Jesus, spoke the truth to his accusers, he actually would justify himself by quoting the law. First, he would actually quote the law of the Heavenly Father. Then, he would actually quote the law of his accusers, and then use that very law against them as well. What do you mean, Tazadaq? Well, for example, he would actually quote the laws of Yah, of God. Then he would turn around and say, is it not written in your law? And quote their own law. And his accusers would actually have no answer. They could actually not overcome him. He dealt with wisdom and knowledge. Now, how could anyone actually overcome someone that's actually quoting both the laws of the Most High and man's law? So, if a man made laws just, brothers and sisters, it was actually be in harmony with the laws of the Heavenly Father, the law of the universe. Now, there are maxims, and these maxims were actually foundations and principles of the law that man actually passes today. But unfortunately, men actually enforce their own will more than they actually enforce law. So this is why, in addition to knowing the laws of Yahweh, it's also important to know man's law. Because man's law is actually based on the laws of he, or the entity which you refer to as God, or the Most High, or Elohim, or Allah, and so on and so forth. So, when you are accused of breaking the law, you can actually do what justice did. You could use both the laws of the Creator and man's law to actually justify your lawful acts. And this is the only thing that will actually excuse you, brothers and sisters. As I previously stated in other lectures, you cannot successfully live under a government and not know law. You must know law. Now, it's important to distinguish between commercial laws, brothers and sisters, and maxims of law. Now, when quoting their laws, we should actually never consent to standing under their codes, their rules, their regulations, their ordinances, their statutes, their merchant laws, their public policies, and so on and so forth, because these are commercial in nature. And brothers and sisters, if we use their commercial law under the presumption and assumption, they would actually assume that we are operating in commerce and we're of the world. And we actually are. If we're operating in commerce, we're of their world, which would actually nullify our witness, because you're not of this world. Now, once you nullify our witness or maxims, brothers and sisters, of law are not commercial law, but they are mostly based upon scripture and truth. Knowing thus, if you are subpoenaed, and we're going to get to my subject matter here, which is actually, again, child support, parents versus mothers, fathers, daughters, and sons. That's my subject. So knowing thus, if you're actually subpoenaed to court for child support, one or two things have actually happened, occurred. The mother has actually come after you, or she actually received some type of benefit, and the state has decided to come after you. She and they are operating in commerce. The state is actually not in the best interest of your son or daughter, which they label child. And some of you ignorantly label child. But a child is a corporation, and a child is not your son or daughter when dealing in law. So the state is not in the best interest of your son or daughter, and they're damn sure not in the best interest of the father, nor are they in best interest of the mother. Did you know that for each dollar that you pay the state for child support, they get two? So they're actually being paid hand over fist. And in order to get paid, they actually have to enforce these child support acts and statutes and so on and so forth. So do you really think that they're going to allow you to escape child support without a vicious battle? Do you know how many dollars that takes out of these attorneys, social service workers, judges' pockets, and so on and so forth for these court hearings? Do you realize that? You better learn some law. So law today is commercial, brothers and sisters, created by merchants, actually influenced by Roman law, and used for commercial purposes. In fact, it's really not law at all. It is color of law. It is public policy. It is public policy, brothers and sisters. Now, what I'm going to go over real briefly is some maxims of law. But I would first like to explain what exactly a maxim is. And then we're going to look at certain maxims of law and see if this could actually help you out. Law today is actually commercial and created by merchants, again, influenced by Roman law and used for commercial purposes. Now, customs of merchants is actually a system of customs. Did you hear me? It's actually a system of customs originating among merchants and allowed for benefits of trades as part of common law. Law merchants, these are actually rules that are applicable to commercial paper and transplanted into the common law for merchant law. They actually had their origin in the customs and in the course of business of merchants and bankers, these damn world bankers, and are actually now recognized by court because they are demanded by the wants and conveniences of these merchants or the mercantile world. Did you hear me? So Roman law, brothers and sisters, Roman law is the common law of England and has actually been largely influenced by Rome, by the law of Rome, in several respects. Now, though the development of commercial law, or should I say, it was actually through the development of commercial law. And all of man's laws, brothers and sisters, except for maxims of law, were essentially commercial in nature. Now, I'm going to give you a definition of maxims and some relevant maxims of law. Maxim, according to Bouvier's Dictionary, 1856, an established principle of proposition, a principle of law universally admitted as being just and consonant with reason. Maxims, according to Black Law's Dictionary, fourth editions, maxims are but attempted general statements of rules of law and are law only to the extent of application in adjudicated cases. Now what I want to give you is something taken from the ownership of children. And I encourage you to memorize this. And I quote, "The offspring following the conditions of the mother. This is the case of slaves and animals. But with regard to free men, children follow the conditions of the father." Trying to split children. I encourage you to memorize this as well. First, that no man can hold one and the same land immediately of two several lords. Secondly, that one man cannot of the same land be both lord and tenant. And it is to be observed that it is holden for an inconvenience that of any maxims of law should be broken through a private man suffer loss, for that by infringing of a maxim, not only a general prejudice to many, but in the end, public-like uncertainty and confusion to all would follow. So, no man, another maxim, is no man can be at the same time tenant and landlord, and one cannot be agent and patient in the same matter. That is a maxim as well. Now, what does this mean? This means, brothers and sisters, you are either your son's a daughter, or I'm going to use the word child because that's the language that they speak in. So you're either the child's father, which makes that your son or daughter, or the judges. No man could hold the same land immediately of two several landlords. Do you understand? Do you understand, brothers and sisters? That could only be one father. That could only be one father. One main guardian of the child, not two. And that's the language that they use, like guardian and so on and so forth. So be careful when you're using such language and make sure that you understand. So one cannot be agent and patient in the same matter. You could either be your son's or daughter's father or the judge is. No man could hold two lands immediately or two several landlords. There can only be one father of the son or daughter, not two. Another maxim is an heir is another self and a son is part of the father. I hope you're understanding what I'm saying to you. Two cannot possess one thing in its entirety. Black Law's Dictionary, 6th edition, page 502. Meaning, well, what does that mean? Do you understand what I'm saying to you? That means, brothers and sisters, only one people or only one of us could actually own our son or daughter. And there's only four choices. That's the father. That's the state. That's the mother. But she's a subsidy and thereby cannot really own the son or daughter. You said, what are you talking about, tazadaq? I'm talking about according to the laws of the Heavenly Father and according to real law, not according to your opinion and your emotions. That's what I'm talking about. So she cannot really own the child. And the fourth is the child as an unemancipated minor. And another maxim states that God, not man, makes heir. So man cannot determine or make the heir. Now I have a question for you. Knowing thus, let me ask you a question that's relevant. Do you own your sons and daughters? Or do you think you own children? If you do not own your sons and daughters, who you refer to as your children, who does? If you are a minority, which is a minor, and this has nothing to do with numbers, how in the hell could you own children or your sons and daughters if you are a minor yourself? Now, I want you to understand something. Just as it is with bank repossessions, like if they go and repossess a car, excuse me, it follows that if you do not own your children, then the only party that could actually take what you refer to as your children, who is really your sons and daughters, then is the true owner. So the only one that can really take your car is the true owner. It's the same with the children or the owner's representative. In other words, government or the state. They couldn't seize your sons and daughters that you referred to again as children unless the government already owned them. Is that correct? CPS could not come in and snatch your children away unless the government already owned them. Do you follow me? Can anyone says communist de facto? Ladies and gents, the heir is the same as the person with the ancestors. That's another maxim. Now, brothers and sisters, when you hear the president speak, and not just this president, the current one, I've heard others speak, and if you listen to their language, I've even heard Bill Clinton say, our children. Now, although the president used the collective term our to describe children, many of you assume the president is speaking in an individual sense of yours and mine and theirs and hers and hers when he talks about our children. You ignorantly assume, well, he could never mean that the United States owns our children. You say he couldn't mean that the United States own our children or own all our children collectively. And what's even more obvious, the president uses or the use of our children couldn't mean that our sons and daughters belong to the government. Oh, you couldn't think that. Not with the education that you've received. You could not think when the president says or uses the term our children that he means that our sons and daughters belongs to the government, which is truly a de facto existing in fact, but not officially recognized. It's not even a real government. So, and again, you assume when the president says this that he's speaking metaphorically when he describes children as assets. How many of you have ever heard them refer to the children as assets? Surely he doesn't mean our children are actually physical property, you think, that might be registered as assets or of a business or corporation. Now, brothers and sisters, the president, I don't want to say our president, because he's the president of a corporation known as United States, 28 U.S.C. 3002, subsection 15A, if you doubt it. So the president of the corporation known as the United States could not mean this, you assume. Well, tazadaq would be the first to tell you that throughout the course of my studies of law and research, I've learned that the president is actually speaking with great precision when he states our children or our most valuable asset. He means your children are in fact legal property of the federal government, and those state-owned children are worth a lot of money to the government. And he's talking about almost every child in the United States. Now, you'll probably find this lecture disturbing, since it's actually suggesting that mostly mothers are selling their children into slavery. Wait just a minute, tazadaq. You're starting to go off. You're upsetting me. No, you need to listen, brothers and sisters. Many of you listened to me before, and you heard me say, according to 28 U.S.C. 3002, subsection 15A, the United States is not a government. It is a de facto, existing in fact, but not officially recognized. It is a privately owned corporation, and the other 50 states, plus Guam, and the Virgin Islands, and so on and so forth, are mere corporate franchise to the United States. The United States only deals in commerce, and does so under maritime admiralty law, which is private international law. Do you hear me? If you don't hear me, you had better work the hell up and start to hear me. Now let's get down to some truth. On April the 9th, 1912, the United States Incorporated, or INC, created the Children's Bureau and the Department of Commerce and Labor to keep track of America's children. To keep track of your sons and daughters, they made them children. Ties the dot with your sources. 62nd Congress, Session 2, Chapter 73, pages 79 to 80. That's my source. Now, why did this not alarm you people? Why didn't a red flag go up? Then in 1921, Congress passed the Shepherd-Towner Maternity Act that actually created the United States Birth Registry Error. What are my sources? Public Law, 97. 67th Congress, Session 1, Chapter 135, 1921. Now, brothers and sisters, the Shepherd-Towner Act actually allowed parents to register their children when they are born, and they receive a copy of what is known as a birth certificate. Mothers are not listed on the certificate of live birth, but are as an informant, because she informs the state that she has more property for it. The mothers, even if they're married, is asked to list her maiden's name, which makes the son or daughter children, and the children appear to have no father, and therefore are listed as bastards, and the state becomes the father when the mother signs the child over. Now consider the fact that in order to be registered, brothers and sisters, for school, because you're no longer enrolled. They used to use the term enroll, but now you're registered. And when you register for anything, you give up title. And if you doubt me, you do the research. And the only true title is the MSO. So when you register for school, apply for a marriage license, to get grants, or for scholarships in schools, the state of New York actually requires a certified copy of a birth certificate. Why? Why does the federal government require a certified copy of a birth certificate? Why, brothers and sisters, when applying for military services, when applying for a passport, when applying for a Social Security card? Could it be that without a birth certificate, you couldn't attend, or should I say be forced to attend, the public school system? You couldn't get or be forced to get certain licenses, and you couldn't even apply for a Social Security card? And without a Social Security card, how could you be liable to pay income taxes? Do you follow me? So, brothers and sisters, this relationship established with this birth certificate with the government seems to make us federal children. And children and subjects of the Congress. A copy of the birth certificate is actually sent to the Department of Vital Statistics in the state in which the son or daughter, that they now refer to as child, was birthed in. Now, the original birth certificate is actually sold into the Sea of Commerce by way of the Department of Commerce in the District of Columbia. And your son or your daughter's future labor properties and body are put up as collateral for the public debt. Do you understand? A debt that was created by the government, not by you and I, or your sons and daughters. This is the first step, brothers and sisters, in the United States INC. It's control and custody of your sons and your daughters, rendering them federal children. Do you understand? So to those of you that think this is just some story that tazadaq has nothing better to do than to sit around and make up stories, whoa is you. Woe is you, brothers and sisters. Woe is you. Perhaps these assertions seem ridiculous, but just ask any parent who's actually ever had to be divorced in a custody case and had the battle. Ask them if the battle, if the judge didn't act as if the state, not the mothers and fathers that they call parents, own the children. But nevertheless, brothers and sisters, the government's ownership of your sons and daughters is not a secret. You're just ignorant. You're just minors with BS degrees. And a BS is exactly what it is in most cases, because it's not teaching you the truth. Now, there are many court cases which actually openly declare that our purported de facto government virtually owns our sons and daughters that they now refer to as children. For example, according to Tillman versus Robert, 108 SO 62 214 Alabama 71, the primary control and custody of infants is with the government. Also, brothers and sisters, according to Nicholas versus Nicholas, in its capacity of parent pirate, the government may assume direction, control, and custody of children and delegate such authority to whom it may see fit. So don't tell me that they do not own the children. Now, brothers and sisters, this actually suggests that the government has authority to have your sons and daughters raised and taught whatever the government think is best. Do you understand? So, as a parent, you have no legal authority over your children. As a mother and father, you have authority over your sons and daughters, but you sold their birthright, mother. Genesis, the 25th chapter. Although you may have equitable possession and control over your children, they are legally property of the state. And the legal authority is what's most essential. Do you understand? This is why the government tends to actually dismiss parents' complaints about subjects like outcome-based education. Now, under 28 U.S.C. 3002.15, because they are a corporation, complaints to offices of a private international company known as the United States about what they're doing with their property, the children that you thought was yours, because you was the biological mothers and fathers, but mother sold you over, children. You say, tazadaq, this is ludicrous. Well, oh yeah? Well, most parents no longer have any legal standing to question the challenges or challenge or complain about any government legislation or regulation pertaining to children. And if you doubt me, Look it up. And as property, even the children, brothers and sisters, have no right, since only real people owned by no one but themselves or the creator have rights. Persons don't have rights. Now, I have warned you people that you had better wake up and study law and procedure, because if you don't, the law, study the law, if you don't know the law, you're just wards of the state. We must study law to be responsible for ourselves and our sons and daughters. Well, okay, Tazadaq, where's the remedy? Where's the magic sheet of paper that I can sign out of this mess? Shut up. You're starting to act like niggas. Brothers and sisters, many of you, and I know this hurts, you always want something for nothing. You always want to be given a short answer. You never want to take the time and effort to learn for yourselves. If you want to be a nigger, we can't help you, Lazarus. Do you want a remedy, sisters? Maybe some of you do, but the vast majority of you do not. Do you want a remedy? Social service, caseworker, judge, lawyers, liars? No. You don't want a remedy because you get paid hand over fist or for this germ called child support that actually has infested many mothers and others with the sickness that kills families of America. You say how remedy can come, but let's look at it. You say, how could remedy come? Well, brothers and sisters, Negroes, blacks, and colors, and African Americans, and whites, and Hispanics are all persons and corporations, so you can't expect the remedy. Now, what I'm about to say is going to upset feminists, but those of you that know me know that I'm compelled to tell the truth, and the truth will make you mad, then make you free. Sisters, we gotta talk. And this is love, not hate. Now let's look at these facts. Let's look at these facts. What I'm about to say is facts, facts, facts. So you want a remedy. So you want a remedy. Well, you say, how can remedy come from a nigger? Well, that's not me, brothers and sisters. That's not me. I know who I am. Do you? You so-called blacks, Negroes, coloreds, African Americans, Hispanics, Jamaicans, Trinidadians, any of these bywords that you refer to yourselves as, had better wake up immediately. Now, what I'm going to say, again, is going to upset feminists. But those of you that know me, again, you know that I'm going to tell the truth, despite who it may irritate. So again, sisters, we got to talk. And this is love. You want love? I'm giving you love. Let's look at the facts. Facts. I'm looking at the facts. You want to fix this sickness of child support? Let's look at it. Facts. Now, according to some studies, mothers, are responsible for 60% of all child abuse, and stepfathers are 8 times as likely to physically and sexually abuse our sons and daughters as a biological father. That's a fact. Now, if you look at these numbers, brothers and sisters, and I encourage you to do so, it becomes obvious that the parent least likely to abuse our sons and daughters is the biological father. So do you really want to reduce child abuse, mothers? Do you really want to re- deuce, child abuse, judge, lawyers, social service? Do you really want to reduce the abuse of our sons and daughters? Then you will have to reverse the maternal presumption in your divorce law and in your custody terminations that actually favors women over men in family law issues. Now, how many of you women really care enough about your sons and daughters' abuse to forfeit your personal stake in the maternity presumption? Not very many, if any at all. Now that pendulum is swinging back at you sisters. It is a fact. Fact, fact, fact. According to government statistics, women file for 70% of all divorces. Now, part of the reason women are twice as likely to file as men is that the maternal presumption provides an incentive for women to do so. Now, since losing the maternal presumption may diminish the number of divorces filed and therefore the income of lawyers and judges, in particularly lawyers, how many lawyers and legislators care enough about our sons and daughters to forfeit their financial interest in maintaining the maternal presumption? Very few, if any. Now, if the stepfathers are eight times, brothers and sisters, eight times as likely as the biological fathers to commit abuse on our sons and daughters, be it physically and sexually and so on and so forth, it is obvious that the number of stepfathers that actually exacerbate this child abuse could be dramatically reduced if we actually eliminated the no-fault divorce and made divorce, as it is in scripture, a very difficult thing to come by for the sake of the sons and daughters. Divorce may become once again uncommon as justice taught in the scriptures. Now, I'm giving you truth and I'm giving you facts, brothers and sisters. Now, how many judges, how many lawyers, how many welfare workers, how many court-appointed psychologists, how many politicians are really appalled by the abuse of our sons and daughters that they would actually support the new laws to make divorce less common and less lucrative for family or for the family law industry? Virtually none. Because that is too close to biblical standards. And these devils do not want to uphold the laws of the Heavenly Father. So a recent government study indicates that 75% of all divorces are caused by financial stress. But government currently takes about 55% of every adult's income on a local, state, and federal tax level. Now, if the government, which takes half of the income, is the chief cause of our financial stress and therefore a primary cause of divorce, because the government takes over half of a man's income, a father can no longer take home enough money to support his family. What are the results of that? The results, if his wife is actually forced to work to make ends meet. What is the results of that? Mom is not home to raise the children. And the truth is, sisters, many of you say, I'm not going to raise its own children. My career is more important. So the father's not home. The mother's not home.
Who's raising the children? Children grow up in daycare centers. Children grow up at Lachi Kids. Children grow up with their family being Crips, Bloods, Folks, 18th Street, and so on and so forth. The result? The mothers lose respect for their husbands, foolishly assuming that they're not good providers because of something that government has fixated. And husbands lose self-respect, assuming they're not good providers themselves because something that government has orchestrated. Do you follow me? So what is the result? Marital stress, drug, alcohol abuse, excessive sex to escape, and it leads to divorce. How many marriages can actually survive without the spouses actually mutually respecting each other? Now, since the probability of child abuse is actually increased by both divorce and poverty, how many of you political figures, how many of you politicians and government agencies truly care enough about stopping child abuse to reduce these government taxes to levels that actually minimize financial stress on families, which would actually thereby encourage spousal respect and thereby reduce the possibility or the probability of poverty, divorce, and the abuse of our children? Almost none of you. Almost zero. So while feminists, lawyers, welfare workers, court-appointed shrinks, politicians, and government officials cry and struggle day and night for tougher child abuse laws, even if it means taking the Constitution of the Federal Republic, not one of these special interest groups would actually take effective collective action to reduce the root cause of the abuse of our children. Why? Why? Because every one of these groups, collectively, brothers and sisters, profit from various unjust laws or attitudes, these maternal presumptions, easy divorce, a sex tax, and so on and so forth, which actually help cause the abuse of our children. Now, you could like it, understand it, believe it or not, but I'm giving you the truth. I'm giving you truth. I'm giving you truth, brothers and sisters. So this is the truth. Now, the fact is, brothers and sisters, the one group, this is the fact. Now, I don't care how emotionally upset you become, but this is the fact. This is the fact according to these statistics. The fact is, the one group that is least likely to commit, cause, or profit from the abuse of our children are the biological fathers. Fact. According to your own governmental statistics. So, if the one group that's least likely to commit or cause or profit from the abuse of our sons and daughters or the biological fathers, why are we routinely scorned, disrespected, or ignored by the government, by courts, by feminists, and by their media? Don't deceive yourselves. Despite, brothers and sisters, all the emotional rhetoric surrounding the abuse of our children, our children have no special entrance clout. They don't vote or make political campaign. If there is no real government or collective incentive to protect our sons and daughters, then who will protect them? The answer is, brothers and sisters, is old as time itself and can be seen in 99% of all mammals and birds. The answer is the biological fathers and mothers operating as an intact family? That's your answer. Every law, institution, policy, or attitude that causes or encourages or merely allows the breakup of the biological family unit ultimately contributes to the abuse of our sons and daughters. Did you hear me? So as long as family law is written to favor special interests that actually profits the destruction of family, child abuse, as they say, which is actually the abuse of our sons and daughters, will not only continue, brothers and sisters, it will increase. And this is strategy that's being used by a de facto. Now, you can like it, understand it, or believe it or not, but you've heard the statistics that I've given according to their own governmental statistics. This is not something that I'm creating, that Tazadaq has created. I'm only citing what their statistics say. So this increase actually must be recognized for what it is, brothers and sisters. It's actually manufactured by forces outside of the family, government, and registered rather than used as a reason to further destabilize the union of man and woman, to destabilize marriage and diminish the rights of all Americans. You're not Americans anymore, most of you. You're United States citizens. You have no rights. So the first thing that you have to learn, brothers and sisters, you want some remedy? The first thing that you have to learn is that you do not have a child. A child is a corporation. A child is a corporate fiction. What is a child? Definition of a child in Black Law's dictionary, in the law of negligence, and in the law of protection of children, etc., it is used as the opposite of an adult. It means the young of the human species, generally under the age of puberty, without any reference to parentage and without distinction of sex. What is a parent? See, you have to learn these words of legalese. A parent, according to Black Law's dictionary, is the lawful father or mother of a person. Of a person. Now, we know that a person is a corporation, but you think they're just talking about a natural living soul. It's of a person. So this word is actually distinguished from ancestors, including only the immediate progenitors of the person, while the latter embraces his more remote relatives in ascending line. Then what is a guardian? A guardian is a person. There's that word person again. A corporate fiction, a corporation. A guardian is a person lawfully invested with the power and charged with the duty of taking care of person and managing the property and rights of another person. So guardian is looking after another person. If you're your child's guardian, you're just a person taking care of another person, and both of these persons belong to the corporation owner. Do you follow me? Do you understand? It's heavy, brothers and sisters. It's heavy. A guardian is a person appointed to take care of the person or property of another. So, if you have been sued for child support, it is essential to remember that you have sons and daughters which are living souls. You have to take a paternity test to show that it is your son or daughter, and then tell them to show you where you gave up rights to your son or daughter over to the state. Again, brothers and sisters, a child is an artificial person. The state created the child, and the state and others have an interest in the child. A son or daughter is part of the estate of the child. Do you follow me? So, if you are capable of totally supporting your sons or daughters without any assistance from the de facto. This means schooling, so on and so forth, medical expenses, and so on and so forth. Most people are not. If you're capable of doing that, you could cancel the registration and claim the infant as your own. But you have to be capable of providing for your son or daughter totally on your own without support from the de facto. You must contact the governor, the secretary of state, of the cabinet for health and family services. Tell them that you actually made a mistake for educational purposes by registering and claim the infant as your own. But you brothers and sisters, before you do this, check the status before doing anything and check the statutes in the state where you're domiciled. And along with that, a few maxims to remember is the heir of my heir is my heir. When dealing with rights of fathers, brothers and sisters, no one can have servitude over his own property. It's a maxim of law. He who provides for himself provides for his heirs. Remember, the son is the heir of the father. Husband and wife are considered one person in law. That's a maxim of law. So your wife shouldn't be testifying against you. You can't testify against yourself. A privilege is a personal benefit and dies with the person. That's a maxim of law. Parental powers should consist in infection, not atrocity. No one can owe to himself. Again, the husband and the wife is one. Keep these maxims of law in mind. Do you follow? Do you understand what I'm saying to you? No one is obliged to accept a benefit against his consent. So you're not compelled to accept any kind of governmental benefit. You don't have to accept it. Is a Social Security a benefit? Is it or is it not? No officer can compel any good and lawful man to get a license, benefit, a privilege in commerce. Do you understand what I'm saying? You can't be compelled. No one is obliged to accept a benefit against his consent. That's a maxim of law. No one is presumed to have preferred another's prosperity to his own. The child knows his father's bed best. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? These are maxims, brothers, that you should know. He who is in the womb is considered as born whenever it is for his benefit. So according to this maxim, there can be no abortions due to this maxim. Children are the blood of the parents, but the father and mother are not the blood of the children. That's a maxim of law. I'll give you a few more maxims, and then I'll close this out. A judge cannot punish a wrong done to himself. So a judge can preside over a case that includes himself. A judge cannot be a witness in his own cause. A maxim of law. No one may be judged over his own cause. A maxim of law. No one can be a witness in his own cause. A maxim of law. So I hope you are absorbing this information. The law always gives remedy. That's a maxim. If there's no remedy, it's not law. An act of God does wrong to no one. That's a maxim. The execution of law does no injury. It's a maxim of law, brothers and sisters. You are to know these maxims of law and law. Who owns the child? If you have paid child support, brothers and sisters, consider this. Consider this. The execution of a law does no injury. Mistakes, neglect, or misconduct are not to be regarded as accident. Whoever pays by mistake what he does not owe may recover it back. But he who pays knowing he owes nothing is presumed to give. Do you understand that maxim, brothers and sisters? So I ask you, fathers, have you paid child support by mistake? Who owns the child? If the state claims ownership of the child, someone just may owe you money. One has paid knowing it not to be due, with the intention of recovering it back, he cannot recover it back. That's a maxim. So in other words, brothers and sisters, if child support services or IRS accuses you of owing them money, if you want to go to court to dispute it, you must pay them in full what they demand and then sue them to get it back, which places the burden of proof on the accused, meaning the one charged with the offense, especially the defendant rather than the accuser. So you need to keep these maxims in mind. Anyone may renounce a law introduced for his own benefit. No one is obliged to accept a benefit against his consent. He who receives the benefit should also bear the disadvantage. So be careful accepting these governmental benefits. He who enjoys benefits ought to also bear the burden. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about consenting to these contracts, then I'm going to close this thing out. Consent makes the law. A contract is a law between the parties which can acquire force only by consent. That's a maxim of law. Consent makes law. The term of a contract, lawful in its purpose, constitutes the law as between the parties. To him consenting, no injury is done. I hope you understand that. Because you love to consent. So there's no injury done because you agree, in other words. He who consents cannot receive an injury. So if you're consenting, whether it be out of ignorance, because ignorance of the law is no excuse, then no injury has been done. You have a responsibility to know the law. Consent removes or obviates a mistake. He who mistakes is not considered as consenting. That's the maxims of law. So, brothers and sisters, I hope and pray that you are encouraged to study some law and be able to present yourself. So, in my conclusion, again, I encourage you to study some law, know the law, learn the law, to get out of this madness. What is your status? What is your nationality? You have to be in proper persona and claim your proper status to get out of this madness. Once again, my name is Brother Tazadaq. I say Shalom, Islam to you all.